Dobrý den, good morning, moin moin, herzlich willkommen and hi to 50 minutes of some interesting facts and stuff about IPv6. I hope you really came here for IPv6, we had some changes in the schedule, so if this is not what you're expecting, now is your time to leave, although if IPv6 makes you want to leave, you better stay here to learn a bit more about it. So, first of all, one little slide about who I am. As you might have already read, I'm Fabian. I work for a Canadian nonprofit called Linux Professional Institute. You might know us because we're doing those tests and award certificates to people passing those tests. And I'm taking care of the product development at LPI. Besides, I'm doing some consultant and some training work. I wrote a book on IPv6, which kind of is the reason why I'm talking to you about it today. And I'm the co-founder of a consulting company based in Germany. So today I'd like to talk with you about internet protocols, and whenever you come to a talk about internet protocols, there's one single slide that you really expect to be shown, and it's that one. So you probably all know how the various protocols are stacked over each other in order to form what we consider the internet. In general, the internet, as you probably know, is not one single kind of network, but it's a great combination of various networks that are connected to each other. And in order to somehow build this connection, we need various kinds of protocols. And those protocols are applicable to various layers. On the very base layer, we have what we call the link layer. Those are devices that are directly attached to each other, that can directly talk to each other. And on those layer, we usually use something like Ethernet or Wi-Fi, where we have some kind of direct connection and some kind of addressing scheme that in the IPv6 terminology is called the link layer. So usually we're not talking about MAC addresses anymore, we're talking about link layer addresses in order to be more generic in terms of what kind of link layer we're using. Since those networks are distinct and usually just little islands, we need some way to bring data out of those networks into other networks, and that's where routing helps us. Routing is a way for us to bring data from one network to another network, but in order to route packets in between various networks, we need some kind of way to address devices beyond the scope of a single network, and that's where the Internet Protocol helps us. The Internet Protocol provides addressing beyond individual networks and allows routing in between those networks. And then on top of the internet, we have protocols like TCP or UDP that provide multiplexing within various applications running on the respective nodes. And we have a couple of additional layers for various protocols that we're using. This stack in general is how all our routing and all our networking works. And as you see in the slide, it's only IP. It's not saying IPv6 or IPv4, it's just IP. So the overall idea of this stack is to be able to replace various protocols on those layers. And one of those replacements that we're trying for like almost 19 years now is to replace IPv4 with IPv6. The reasons why we're doing this is mostly a lack of addresses. So the IPv4 address space is really run out. It's super hard to get new addresses these days, especially if you're trying to start as an ISP. So getting new addresses is one of the major concerns. This is one of the various aspects IPv6 tries to solve. IPv6 tries to solve tons of other problems or like things that are not even really a problem in addition, and that makes it kind of hard to learn and to get started with. In addition to the address shortage, we have protocols like DHCP, which are considered complicated, especially by small devices, which, for example, can't store state. We have issues with broadcast, which pollutes networks, and we don't have any standard mechanisms in order to encrypt data. And IPv6 is trying to solve all of that and far more. The development of IPv6 started in 95. Called Internet Next Generation, IPNG, back then, and today we refer to it as IPv6. The biggest change is that we have a significantly bigger address space. So we have tons of addresses so that we can assign addresses to basically anything in the world. Those addresses follow a certain structure, so we can determine specific information based on those addresses. And we have now a common rule how we assign address space to various networks. In addition, we also got new mechanisms in order to configure those addresses. We have something called stateless autoconfiguration, and we have a stateful autoconfiguration, which, whenever the IPv6 world says stateful autoconfiguration, is basically DHCP v6. There are a lot of other things that IPv6 try to solve too, but today we'll focus on the addresses and on the way how we can configure them on devices. So, IP addresses. Let's briefly recap IPv4 addresses, just to be aware of one principle. Overall, IPv4 addresses have 32 bits of length, and we're writing them in four blocks in decimal numbers divided by a dot. You all know those kinds of addresses. When we have such an address and we reconsider the overall principle of having small networks and the goal to route packages between those networks, then we need to somehow determine what network a specific node belongs to. And that's why we need to divide the information in those addresses into two parts. One part, the so-called prefix, which indicates the network that we want to connect to, and another part for the host that indicates what individual node in that network we want to connect to. In order to determine what part of an address belongs to the prefix and to the host, we use something called a netmask, and the netmask basically, in the binary notation of an address, sets a 1 to every bit that belongs to the network and a 0 to every bit that belongs to the node. I think that's a pretty well-known concept. As you see on the slide, I put the binary notations, and when you count the binaries, you come up with something that calls CIDR, the classless inter-domain routing notation. That's a way how we can easily write down the netmask just by specifying how many ones we have in the netmask, and due to the principle of the netmask, all of those ones are on the left-hand side and all the zeros on the right-hand side. So the pure number, how many ones are set in a netmask, is sufficient for us to determine what part of the address is the host and what part is the network. IPv6 heavily uses a principle of CIDR notation, so whenever you're seeing IPv6 addresses, you usually also see a slash whatever in order to indicate the number of bits set in the netmask. That's why I'm referring to this again, because we'll see a couple of those notations today. IPv6 addresses are a little longer than IPv4 addresses. They contain 128 bits, and that brings a pretty huge number, which I actually don't know how to say, as individual addresses. Every unicast address is assigned to a specific network interface. So for every address, there's one network card that uses this address, but unlike in the IPv4 world, usually IPv6 capable network interfaces have various addresses. So there's not just a single address, there can be a handful of addresses, and even two or three handful of addresses. I brought you an example of how an IPv6 address looks like, and you see that if you write down all the digits, become pretty huge, but you can shorten it the way that you're seeing down there. So in general, we have 8 blocks with hexadecimal numbers divided by colons. Case doesn't matter, leading zeros don't matter. We have the ability to shorten blocks of only zeros, which again leads to the difficulty that we have various ways to write down the same address. So if you're using Excel to manage your IP addresses, it's kind of hard to search for stuff because there are so many different ways to write them down. If you want to shorten them, that's a little overview how you can shorten those addresses by taking out zeros and leading blocks and combine them to a pretty condensed way of writing them down, at least if you don't have a lot of stuff encoded in there. IPv6 addresses occur in 3 different kinds. The most common case is a unicast address. A unicast address stands for a single device. We also have anycast addresses, which stand for one single device out of a group. That's, for example, commonly used for name servers, where packets to name servers are routed to the closest name server, but all using the same address. And we have something called multicast, where we send one package and it's sent to a bigger group of nodes. IPv6 doesn't have broadcast anymore, but there is a multicast address for all devices on the link, which in the end turns out to be the very same. Besides those 3 kinds of addresses, we have various scopes. For unicast addresses, there are 3 scopes of addresses. We have so-called link local addresses. They start with FE80. Those addresses cannot be routed, never ever, and their entire scope is the whole link. So those addresses can be used to connect to any device located to the very same link, but not to any device that's not connected to that link. Every IPv6 capable interface needs to have one address out of the FE80/64 device block. Those addresses are used to bootstrap everything else. The entire way of how IPv6 nodes connect to each other is based on those link local addresses. And actually, when you list your IP addresses, no matter whether or not you're using IPv6, if you haven't turned it off, you will see one of those FE80 addresses on every single interface within IPv6 stack. Then we have something called unique local addresses, or ULA. They are supposed to be a little similar to the private addresses that you know. So you can have an own prefix of those ULA addresses. You're allowed to route them within your organization, but they are not valid in the internet. And effectively, the way how you determine your individual ULA prefix, which contains 40 bytes of random digits, is designed in a way that you can't aggregate them when you're trying to route it. So they are specifically designed to not be routed in the internet. The purpose of those addresses is to be independent from a provider. So if you get your global prefix assigned by another provider, and for some reason that provider takes their prefix back, you're lost without any addresses besides the link local ones. And ULA addresses can help you to be still able to reach all your devices within your organization. Then we have global addresses, usually those starting with a 2. Those are the addresses that are routed in the internet, and usually you get those addresses from your provider. All of those networks that you're getting here are, at least for unicast addresses, eventually a /64 prefix. So you get half of the bits just to number the individual devices in every subnet, which is a lot, which is a real lot. Usually, your provider is kind enough to not just get you a /64 prefix. Usually, for most internet connections, you get even more of those addresses. So usually, when you have like a regular home line, you get a /56 prefix. If you're like a bigger company or something, you usually get a 48, which means that you get, at least for a home connection, 256 individual /64 prefixes. Global addresses, globally routable in the internet. That's a lot compared to like maybe the one IPv4 address that your providers grant you. This is how those addresses are designed in the end. So you see the cut in the middle where we're dividing the address in the prefix that determines your network and the interface identifier that's used to enumerate the individual nodes in your network. The prefix itself is again combined of various parts. In this case, you see a /48 prefix that was assigned by your provider and the subnet ID that you're using to somehow fill it up in order to come to a /64 prefix. The interface identifier can come from various sources, but it's usually always determined in a different way than the prefix. So you get the prefix from your provider using the prefix to route. That's one set of addressing, and the other part is where those interface identifiers come from. And effectively, if you have a lot of prefixes, like your link local prefix, maybe global prefixes from two providers, and an ULA prefix, then there's a certain advantage in using the same internet identifiers in all of those prefixes. Interface identifiers can come from various sources. When you're taking a look at your Linux system, you might recognize that your MAC address is encoded in your IPv6 addresses. And that's because the default way of Linux, at least if you don't configure it specifically to do it in another way, the default way is to derive the internet the interface identifier from your link layer address, which is really great because now your IP address contains your MAC address, which is specific for your computer. So whoever sees their access logs can see that it was your MAC address. And in combination with the prefix, they can even see where you are. So that's pretty good, right? At least if you're trying to do like online advertisements and know what your people are doing. If you're on the other side and you want to prevent that, there's something called privacy extensions. They randomize the interface identifier, and they're doing it pretty frequently. So whenever you connect to a new network, and even when a certain time passed, you get a new interface identifier. And there's always a transition period in which you still have the old interface identifier and the new one. So that gives you two times of addresses. And that's how you see how the number of IPv6 addresses that you can have on the same device can increase over time very, very fast. There's also the way to randomly assign static interface identifiers. That's what a lot of Windows servers are doing, for example. They are determining a random interface identifier once and then just keep it forever. So you can put it in DNS, for example. And there is, of course, a way to manually assign it to say, for example, my web server has the :80 in the end, something like that. And behind the scenes, IPv6 does a lot of weird standard redefinitions in order to allow you to use those interface identifiers. But we won't get all that today. The other kind of IPv6 addresses you might see are multicast addresses. Those always start with FF. Then they have some bits, which we won't discuss today. And they have a scope. And the scope that's really important for us is the 2, which is, again, the link layer. So those addresses starting with FF02 are multicast addresses that reach out to all subscribers of those multicast groups on the same link. And those addresses are used, again, heavily by IPv6 in order to, for example, find other devices, find other nodes, and do automatic configuration. One application of this is the so-called stateless address auto-configuration. That's a new way that IPv6 introduces, which is supposed to make auto-configuration far more simple than DHCP used to be. DHCP still exists, and we can use it in various combinations. So we have the stateless address auto-configuration, where routers effectively just yell into the network, that's our prefix, have fun with it. We can use DHCP in addition if we want to distribute specific information, like, for example, what's the address of our DNS server, in case you want to reserve a name or something like that. And alternatively, we could use DHCP in order to handle individual addresses. And I'll introduce you to all the 3 of those concepts, including how you should combine them, because none of them is really sufficient on its own. In order to understand how the stateless address auto-configuration works, we need to know more about states of IPv6 addresses. Every address can be in one of those states. So as soon as a new address is configured, it's in a state called tentative. In that state, it might not be already used, but the individual node does something called duplicate address detection. So effectively, it just sends some packets in the network to see if someone else is using this address. And that can be used for very funny attacks. If you're just responding to all of those packets, no IPv6 addresses will come up anymore on your network. That's pretty easy and pretty funny. Once this succeeded, the address is valid, and it's in a state called preferred. How long this state lasts depends on the so-called preferred lifetime. It's usually infinite for manually configured addresses, and there is some kind of counter running for all automatically configured addresses. Once this preferred lifetime is over, the address becomes deprecated. That means it's still there, it still can be used for another amount of time, that's determined by the valid lifetime, but if there is another address in a preferred state, then that address should be used instead. And once the lifetime is over too, the address becomes invalid and can't be used anymore. The stateless address auto-configuration works by routers which send so-called router advertisements, where the router says, I'm a router for a specific amount of time, and that's a prefix that's used on this network. Every node that receives this router advertisement then configures the router as default router and sets a route saying all packets to this network should immediately be sent out to that specific interface. In addition, a router advertisement can declare a prefix for autonomous configuration. In that case, all the recipients of those router advertisements just build up any address they like from this prefix, do the duplicate address detection, and then use that address. And the preferred and valid lifetimes are included in those router advertisements so that the clients know how long they are allowed to use this address. The individual nodes, however, don't communicate with the router about the addresses they've chosen based on the router advertisements. They might send out some information to the network that they are using the address, but they don't need to somehow sign a contract like with the DHCP where they need to agree to a lease. So the router initially gets no feedback what client is using what address. That's very important to understand. In addition, router advertisements can declare the sender as a default router, so they can say, I'm a default router. They can specify specific routes that should be pointing to the sender. They can say there is additional information available through DHCP, and they can even say, don't configure any of those addresses, but try DHCP in order to get your addresses. So that can be declared in there too, and a couple of other things. The prefixes included in here have a length, so we are saying how long is the prefix for the individual route, what are the valid lifetimes, and is it on-link or not. And especially this on-link property is the only way how you can automatically distribute a prefix to your clients. DHCP can only assign individual addresses, but it can tell your clients it's a /64 prefix. Try to reach out your neighbors directly. Just can do it. On Linux, if you're trying to set up a router, you'll usually use the router advertisement daemon. That's just an excerpt of the configuration, how you can, for example, declare a prefix. And there you're saying with the ADV autonomous on, go ahead and just configure those addresses. I don't know if that's big enough to be read. That's how those packages look like. And that's more interesting. That's how this communication looks like. So we have a router that, in a certain period, sends a router advertisement to the multicast address FF02:1. That's all potential pens on one link. So that's effectively broadcast. So all nodes get that. And all nodes then usually start to configure themselves based on the information in the router advertisement. In addition, nodes can send a router solicitation, which is sent to a dedicated address where all routers join, FF02:2. And all routers that receive that advertisement, solicitation then again send an advertisement. So that's the way how to trigger the transmission of new router advertisements in case, for example, a node boots and needs this kind of information. So once a node receives a router advertisement, it starts to configure those addresses, and there are two clocks ticking. One clock is for the valid lifetime, and the other one is for the preferred lifetime. And every time a new router advertisement is received, those clocks are reset. So as long as our node keeps receiving router advertisements, those clocks are always reset, and the addresses don't go away because the lifetime is always extended before it runs out. If, for some reason, we stop to receive router advertisements, those counters continue to run. And then, suddenly, the preferred lifetime will be over, the address becomes deprecated. If another address is in place, that address will be used. And once the valid lifetime is over, those addresses disappear again. Again, those lifetimes can be used to do very funny things in the network. So if there is nothing on the link layer that prevents you from doing it, you can just declare yourself a default router by sending out a couple of router advertisements. And you can cause the configuration of IPv6 addresses just by sending out a handful of addresses in your network if you don't take any additional means to protect your network against it. So since this information is just distributed to basically anyone on the network, we don't have any way to limit what nodes can configure themselves. So some people, for example, always encode all the individual MAC addresses in their DHCP configuration in order to prevent nodes from taking part in the network. That's not possible anymore with router advertisements because it's just sent out. We don't have an overview like the lease overview in a DHCP server, so we don't know what configuration we actually caused. And for a long time, there was no option to somehow distribute the DNS information. So we could configure addresses, but we couldn't configure the DNS servers. That was changed in 2007, so a little ago, but there might be still legacy devices around that don't support those configuration options. It's also a little hard to deconfigure addresses because you can't reset the lifetimes to zero, at least not the valid lifetime, in order to protect yourself against certain attacks. There's something called SEND, the secure neighbor discovery, which I've never seen in practice anywhere. So effectively, there are certain limitations, especially if you want to revoke addresses again. DHCP v6 is trying to help us a little here. First of all, DHCP v6 has specific options that can carry, for example, IP addresses of DNS servers. That's our way how we distribute DNS information in our networks. It can support tons of other options, and there are a lot of definitions for those options. And we can use, yet alone, the ability to declare those options without assigning any addresses. In a router advertisement, we would have the so-called O flag set for options, and when it's the M flag for it's the O flag that's wrong. So there is a flag in the router advertisements to indicate that there are options available, and client that understands this option just send a so-called information request, and then in return get a list of specific informations. They don't get addresses, they don't get a lease, they just get a list of options like that's our DNS server, for example, that's our time server, that's our Pixie boot server. Alternatively, something called stateful configuration can be done. That's a little hard to understand because in the IPv6 terminology is always stateful configuration and everybody else calls it DHCPv6. But it's effectively the same. So when we're trying to assign complete addresses, not just a prefix, but an entire address to a node, then that's done in the stateful way. And you might know the overall principle from DHCPv4, but there are a few little very mean things that are different with DHCPv6. First of all of the participants in DHCP have something called a DUID, a DHCP unique ID. And this ID is the only way to identify a specific client. So you're not supposed, for example, to use the MAC address anymore. You're supposed to use the DHCP unique ID of that client, which is randomly assigned whenever you install an operating system, which effectively means if you have one computer with various operating systems, each of them has a different unique ID. And from the DHCP point of view, it's a different system. Along with those DUIDs, so-called identity associations are used with the DHCPv6 in order to assign addresses to nodes. And there are three kinds of those identity associations. There is one for normal addresses. That's what you know from IPv4. So you get an entire address, it's valid for a certain amount of time, you can renew it if you want to keep it for a longer time. There are temporary addresses, and they are trying to implement something similar to the privacy extensions, except that the DHCP server decides what prefix, what interface identifier you get. So you get a complete address, but with random components in it, and you can renew those addresses. So you just can get a new one with another random component in it, but you can say, I want this a little longer. And that's different, you can also request complete prefixes. So you can tell your DHCP server, I want a /64 prefix, and with a bit of luck, you get it. That's an excerpt from the ISC, the HTTPD configuration file, how this could look like. You see a lot of similarities to the IPv4 configuration. So effectively, it's the same options. You'll just add a 6 in the end. So you have your subnet 6 declaration to say, like, for example, that's the address that's on this link. And in there, you can have the range 6 declaration to say, for normal addresses, we want to use that range of addresses. The line below that declares temporary addresses. You see, it's a different kind of declaration. You need more address space in order to get more bits that you can randomize. But you can use both of those declarations in the same stanza of your configuration file, and then it depends on the client if it requests normal addresses or temporary addresses. You also see that there's the prefix section in there. That effectively means that from this range that we've indicated here, and you see that the difference in the addresses are shifted to the left-hand side, we are assigning individual /56 prefixes to clients requesting it. And that's the way how we can have routers configure entire prefixes that they can in return use in order to address their networks. And that's, for example, what you're also doing when you're dialing up with your provider. So you're also telling them I want a prefix, and usually you get like a 56 or something like that. We see how we can declare options. The availability of options, again, depends on the protocol. So there are different definitions for the options for IPv6 and for IPv4. And finally, we see how we can configure individual nodes. And there you're seeing that we don't have the hardware Ethernet option, but we're saying host identifier, and then there's that ID. And that way, we can identify the individual client, and then we have the fixed address that we want to assign to that client. And those are the three ways how we can configure addresses in DHCP. So those addresses are only borrowed to a client for a specific amount of time. Those addresses still have a valid and a preferred lifetime, but that's independent from the lease time of DHCP, and that requires some tweaking in order to make sure that the addresses don't expire before the DHCP lease expires. Those addresses can just be used by the client, but there's some kind of negotiation happening. On the network, it looks like that. We have the client sending a DHCP solicitation to all the DHCP servers, and you'll see there's again a multicast address for all DHCP servers and relays on our link. In that solicitation, our client can already add some kind of wish list. It could say, for example, I would like to get this address and that option, and then it's up to the server to respond with the hypothetic assignment the client would get if it decides to sign a contract with that server. Then, over time, the client collects all the various responses, picks the server, and then puts out a DHCP request, and then this information is assigned. IPv6 has some kind of shortcut in there, something called rapid commitment, where a client could say, I'm desperate, give me any address, and then it immediately agrees to use that, but that's the way how this kind of negotiation usually works. Along with the assignment of the identity association, our client gets two more times. One of them is called T1, and the other one is called T2, and within this T1 time, our server tries to renew the address with the DHCP server that was used for the initial assignment. If this server, for some reason, is not available anymore, then the client reaches out to basically any other server and asks the entire number of servers on the network whether or not they would be willing to agree to somehow extend the lease time. All this information happens with multicast, so whenever a client wants to talk to a specific target, it sends the information out to that multicast address, but within the individual package, it indicates the DHCP unique ID of the server it's talking to. So there's no unicast in that direction, but all the responses are received by the client by unicast. So let's somehow recap what we've seen so far. We've talked about unicast addresses, which are 128 bits long, and half of this address is used for the prefix, and the other half is used for the interface identifier. We have the various scopes. We have link local addresses that are used, for example, to communicate to a DHCP server, because if I don't have any other address and I want to do DHCP, I need an address in order to talk to the DHCP server, and that's what those link local addresses are for. We've seen that there are ULA addresses that are configured just like global addresses, except that they are not routed in the internet. And we've seen global addresses, which are assigned by our provider and are used for external communications. The interface identifier might contain information like a link layer address or certain thing that we've encoded in there, or it could just be random and it could even change over time. So the interface identifier is nothing that we can use anymore in order to constantly identify any, like an arbitrary node in our network. Because especially if it uses privacy extensions, the interface identifier might just be changed over time and be replaced. So that has a lot of implications if you think about firewalling, for example, how you want to identify who's talking to whom. We've seen that we have basically three options how we can configure our networks. We can entirely rely on the stateless address outer configuration, which nowadays usually is safe because most of the nodes support the extensions for DNS options, so they are able to retrieve that information from router advertisements. That wasn't the case a couple of years ago. We can use stateless outer configuration along with DHCP options in order to distribute specific configuration like DNS servers, but also far more detailed information based on the options available. Or we could just use DHCP v6 stateful configuration. However, if you're doing that, we usually also need router advertisements in order to configure the default router and the subnet length, because with DHCP we can only configure addresses but not a router and not the length of the prefix. So usually when we do DHCP, we also need router advertisements. Those concepts that we've seen have a lot of security considerations. Especially, we need to somehow get away from the idea of doing filtering based on individual IP addresses. And at least in the projects I've seen, that causes a lot of trouble for a lot of people because they really build packet filters based on individual addresses. And that doesn't work anymore if we expect the interface identifiers to change and if we expect every node to have tons of addresses. If every node has a link local address, an ULA address, a global address, maybe two of them because we're just changing interface identifiers and IPv4 addresses in addition, then we have at least seven addresses that we need to somehow reflect in our rule set, and that'll change. So that's nothing that we can really maintain. So what we're seeing is that a lot of security measures are shifted to the link layer. So for example, we're configuring something like radios in order to somehow identify who's on our network. We're trying to have network infrastructure like switches that, for example, prevent rough router advertisements, where someone is just sitting in the network and saying, hey, I'm the best router you could get, send me all your data. And We are also seeing that we are trying to somehow segment nodes into networks and then do firewalling based on those networks, like saying what interface is allowed to talk to what interface and what prefix is allowed to talk to what prefix, but somehow refrain from doing it in an individual node address per address decision. So if you want to get some final words about what we've seen today, first of all, we only covered the principles, and there is tons of different stuff to discover. There are a lot of historic fun facts, how those standards are developed and changed and reversed and changed again over time. Some of them are funny, some of them are pretty frightening. So there are a lot of details that you could go to. We haven't talked a lot about multicast or about the overall principle of neighbor discovery. In case you understand German, you might want to have a look to that website where you can find the book I wrote. But if there's one thing that's really important to take away, don't ignore IPv6 because it won't ignore you. And it can happen as bad as, like, for example, just someone connecting accidentally some device to your network that starts to send router advertisements. And then one morning you come to your company and you see that the entire network has new default routers and new addresses and that all the office computers put those addresses in the Active Directory, in the DNS, and you have a couple of days work to just clean that up. So be aware of those principles and try to somehow configure them in a sensible manner. So that is a brief overview of the various kinds of unicast addresses and of the various kinds of configuration mechanisms. And that's your chance to ask questions about the entire thing. Well, if you don't have any questions, or if you don't want to ask them now, feel free to just talk to me after the talk. I'll be at the LPI booth for another bit of time. And other than that, I have to say thank you for coming by on such short notice. And have fun with IPv6 and happy routing wherever your packets are going.